Behind the scenes, we've been doing a complete overhaul and upgrade to the shop. We upgraded the electric, installed a 100-amp sub panel, ran 7 T8 Stingray light fixtures, 9 new outlets, framed an AC unit, installed insulation, drywall, and painted. All the electrical you see here is going to be up to code and past inspection, but you're going to need to check with your municipality to see if you're even allowed to run your own electric. I'm not an electrician, so make sure that you seek out professional help before attempting anything like you see in the video. First thing you need to do is call 811-DIG to make sure you don't run into any lines while you're digging. They'll be out within a couple of days, so it's better to be safe than sorry. My arborist was insistent that I didn't use a trench digger. We have an oak tree that adds about $10,000 to the property value that this shop is sitting on, and he demanded that I dig around the roots, and so that's what I did. Code for this is 18 inches from the top of the conduit to ground level. That means digging down to 20 just so you can clear it. I use Schedule 40 underground and S80 above ground. And keep in mind that you can only have 360 degrees worth of bend between the two boxes, so make all your turns count. The goal in the workshop was to make each wall on its own breaker, put the AC unit on its own, put the compressor and the powder coat oven on a single 240 outlet, and then break the upstairs into the same idea. I used adjustable boxes that would allow the box to move in and out to align it with the thickness of the drywall. They're about 33 inches from the bottom, which is a perfect height for my hand to be able to plug it in without bending over. These are 20 amp outlets with a 20 amp breaker, and so I use 12-2 Romex wire. 14-2 should not be used on a 20 amp breaker. Under extreme use, it could overheat and the breaker won't flip, leading to a fire. While you may know that it's 14-2 behind the wall, it protects the future owner that might not know it's an undersized wire for the breaker. For the initial setup, I left a foot of wire outside the box, and after inspection, the extra wire was pulled back through just in case anyone down the road wants to make some adjustments. For the lights, I built small frames so they could be put into the recessed parts of the ceiling to give maximum clearance to allow for the possibility for the ceiling to be drywalled later on. 6 T8 lights were evenly spaced out and held up by 2 screws into the new frames. If you like what you see, don't forget to subscribe and head on over to Patreon or my Discord community and join there. Here, the wires are being prepped for the outlets. If you're gonna attach anything to the outlet, leave it accessible for the inspection. Otherwise, you can get everything ready and push it back into the box. Only one ground wire gets attached to the outlet, so trim one of them short, wrap it around the long one, and then hold the back of it while you turn the other side with a pair of pliers to tighten it and give it that professional look. Slide the long wire nut through the hole in the ground wire nut and twist until you can't turn it anymore. You can help this by continuing to hold the back of the connection with your pliers. For the neutral in the ground, make your bend down so that when you tighten the screw, it grabs and pulls the wire in. For the hot, turn it upwards for the same result. Now push the wires to the back of the box and it's ready for inspection. The lights were the only thing in the shop to get 14 gauge wire. Because of this, I put them on a 15 amp breaker. Prime Lights makes it easy to daisy chain these things without the use of pigtails. They have a little connector where you just pop them right in. The wires need to be secured whenever they go into a fixture, and they make clamps that can screw right down into it for the knockout holes. A few extra notes worth talking about. Make sure you don't fill in that trench that you dug earlier before you get inspection. Don't put up your walls or they're gonna make you take them down. From the main breaker to the sub panel, it's 3-gauge copper wire. The main panel was full, but you can open up a slot by combining some of the breakers with low loads. The staples that are holding the wires down are put every 4 to 6 feet, but the board holes count as secured locations so they won't need them. Within 12 inches of the box, make sure you also put a staple. And the last piece of advice is don't forget to label those breakers in the new panel. There are so many small details that are such a big deal when you're trying to pass inspection. Make sure you check out the National Electric Code for free online, but it took me several days to read this thing to figure out exactly what pertained to me in which situations. Here's a look at the new sub panel installed. It's also worth noting the 230s down in the bottom were just thrown in there because it came with the breaker box and it's an easy way to store them. The 7th and final light is going over the top of the workbench. This is obviously to get that LED light shining from the top to get those restoration videos lit up. This shot is more like an unboxing video, so you know what to expect when you order your lights. The first thing you'll need to do is take out the aluminum reflector. It's attached with 2 screws on one side and 2 tabs on the other, and then it lifts right out with the wire. The LED lights have internal drivers, so you don't have to worry about external drivers or ballasts. This is a one-time buy with no maintenance. Hook up the electric, install the lights, flip on the switch, and these things will be good for 50,000 hours. It's hard to put into words how it felt to go from having a single light bulb in the shop to 28 LEDs. They also have housings that hold up to 6 in each, but I figured that was overkill for the shop. The summers here get into the 100s, so an air conditioner is a must. I went with a 12,000 BTU window air conditioner instead of a mini split because of affordability, and that's the only reason. It was a couple hundred for this AC unit versus a couple thousand for the mini split, where I sacrificed the AC versus being able to get some heat from the mini split. I built the frame out the same way the window frame was at the front of the shop, except for making a small slot in the front board of the bulkhead. The windowsill goes on top of the three boards. Your code might be four, so check before building. The two boards on the outside are the continuous jack studs, and they go from the sill plate to the top plate. This will help transfer the load to the floor, along with the king stud on the outside. Repeat the process for both sides. For the insulation, I used R15 for 2x4s. Cut a slit in the back at the height of the wire and around the electrical boxes. I went with a half-inch mold-resistant drywall over the top. The studs used to build this workshop were never intended to have this, so the people installing it put it up without regard, so this drywall didn't always line up. This can be filled in with some extra mud before and apply the tape, but allow some extra time for that compound to dry because it might shrink and crack. I also left a small 1-inch gap under the drywall just in case water ever seeps in above the foundation. There's a low spot behind the workshop, and it's the first thing in the area to fill up during a hard rain. So until the drainage system can be installed, this small gap will help prevent the drywall from getting ruined. And once I get that drainage system fixed, I'll come around with some running boards. From this shot, you can see the slot I cut into one of the two top plates. Now, the civil engineer watching this is probably furious, but this helped me stabilize the unit because the shop doesn't have exterior walls to secure it. Secondly, this allowed me to lock it into the frame with the first board in the bulkhead for security purposes. So far, Mr. Civil Engineer, I've survived one hurricane. It took me a second to decide what I wanted to do, but I left a small slit of drywall missing above the AC unit to help me remove it for cleaning and replacement. I don't know what the max life of a window AC unit is, but I can tell you that this one won't make it all the way. There's been far too much dust in the shop from sanding, sandblasting, and more sanding, and the filter is a little too weak on these units. The evaporator's getting clogged up, which limits the air intake and makes it much harder to cool. Until the heat subsides, I'm cleaning it out with a file card by hand. The temperature change is immediate, so I know it's working harder than it should be. I did insulate under the stairs because I want to keep the area with the two-stage compressor cool. It's going to produce a ton of heat, which will lead to water vapor in the line. While I will also be installing some filters, I don't want to make them work harder than they have to. For the door, I used a high-performance foam insulation board from Home Depot. A standard door allows for 1.5 inches of insulation, but Home Depot only sells the half inch or the inch. So I had to put in the half inch first. I split it into four pieces to maximize coverage, and then I put in the second piece, slid it up, pushed it in, and then slid it back down into place to lock it. This mud shot should look familiar to anyone who's already subscribed to the channel. This was the Goldblatt drywall taping knife video. This was the real shot of the tool being used immediately after the restoration, and I used it for the actual mud at the joints for this restoration. But that's nothing compared to the weight you've had to endure if you saw the Craftsman paint sprayer video when it originally dropped. It was restored well before I needed it, with the hindsight that I was going to need it, so I knew that day was coming. Of course, I'll leave links to those videos down in the description below if you want to see those. For those that left a comment in that video, this shot's for you. It made painting the walls unbelievably efficient. Its only drawback was the paint splatter. To get an even coat, it had to be used relatively close to the wall, but that caused some of the paint to splatter back at me, on the floor, and on the piece itself. I was so happy with the light blue on the mold-resistant drywall in the thumbnail shots that I was taking for the restoration videos that I decided to go with the color that was close to it, just with a little more blue. We'll see how it looks in the next thumbnail. And that's how you go from a workshop with these issues to one that looks like this. This project took 9 months to complete, but to be fair, I was busy restoring tools all along the way, so it was given a huge backseat to the restorations. Make sure you subscribe so you don't miss when part two drops, where I set up the shop, and part three when we do the second floor wood shop. See you next time.